The load manager may be operating at the network level, that is, at the network layer level of the 7-layer OSI reference model. In this case, the load manager is simply a round-robin domain name server. What it does is when client request comes in, they all have the same domain name in order to come to this particular service. If you say gmail.com, then depending on how the server is architected, the Gmail request coming from a particular client may go to a particular site. And when it goes to that site, the domain name server, which is acting as a load manager, what it is going to do is it is going to direct the incoming client request to one of the servers. So it is giving different IP addresses, even though the domain name a client is coming in is exactly the same. The round robin DNS server assigns different IP addresses corresponding to different servers to the incoming client request. And that way, these clients are being redirected to different servers. And because the load manager is doing it at the level of individual server addresses, you get very good load balance. And the inherent assumption in this model is that all the servers are identical. So an incoming request can be sent to any one of these servers, and perhaps the model is also that the data is fully replicated so that if an incoming client request goes to this server, it has access to all the data. If it goes to this server, it has access to all the data to satisfy the incoming client request. So the pro is good load balance because the round-robin DNS scheduler can choose the least loaded server to redirect an incoming client to that particular server. But the con is it cannot hide down server nodes because it is assigning IP addresses of the server to the incoming request. The load manager is not able to hide down server nodes from the external world. So now we move the load manager up in the OSI reference model, up to the transport level or even higher. The load manager could be layer 4 switches, that is transport level switches or even higher level switches. And in fact, the layer 4 switches may be architected as switch pairs so that there is hot failover from one failed switch to another failed switch at the load balancer level. When you do this, architecting the load balancer at the transport or higher levels, it gives you the opportunity to dynamically isolate down server nodes from the external world. And it is also possible with this architecture of the load manager to have service-specific front-end nodes. For example, instead of dealing with arbitrary client requests, we're actually dealing with requests based on the kind of request coming in from a particular client. For instance, this could be a Gmail client. This could be a Google search client. This could be for a photo server like Picasa. So those are different functionalities that can be implemented at the front end of this load manager to look at the service, the particular program that is actually triggering a client request coming in to this particular site and make decisions as to who should serve that particular request. So in other words, we are building more intelligence into the load manager so that it can know the semantics of the client-server communication that is going to happen based on the type of request that is coming in. And it is also possible with this structure of having the load management at higher levels of the OSI reference model to co-opt the client devices in the load management. For example, it's possible that the load manager may even know the device characteristics that the client is using in order to come into the site. For example, if it's a smartphone, it might take certain actions commensurate with the device that is coming in terms of structuring the client-server interactions. Now, the data itself may be partitioned among all the servers. For example, let's say that you are doing a web search and it is a web search that came in as a client request. And if it is redirected to a particular server, this server may not have access to all the data that it needs in order to do that Google search that you came in with. In that case, the server may communicate using the backplane with other servers to get the data that it needs to serve the queries that is coming in so that there is complete coverage of whatever the intended query needs to get as a result. Of course, if the data is partitioned, if a server that is holding a portion of the data is down, then there'll be data loss for the query. So for your specific search, the server that is handling your search may not be able to give you complete result for the search because a portion of the data is down due to the partitioning of the data among the different servers at the site. Now, this is where replicating the servers for redundancy helps. So even though you may partition it, you may replicate partitions so that it is possible that even if one server is down, another server that has a replica of the same partition may be able to provide the data that is needed in order to satisfy a particular query.